Thanks. Yeah, I'm getting my feet wet in sample complexity stuff. So it's a first for sure. Thanks for coming, everybody. Probably all of you have run up against dimensionality as an enemy at some point in your work. And instead of viewing dimensionality with hatred, I hope by the end of the talk you'll view it kind of suspiciously as a potential ally. So that's where we're headed. So this kind of grows out of what happens when you talk to collaborators who do real problems. So one example is I work with a lot of neuroscientists, and they'll say stuff like, hey, they've got some high dimensional undersampled data, and my upbringing actually requires me to try and help no matter what the request is, but I have to do so in a modest way, so I say, okay, I'll try. But what I'm really thinking is, oh man, I've been reading all about high dimensional undersampled methods. I have like these great things where if your data looks anything like this, I've got these awesome methods, tons of awesome methods that you neuroscientists will know anything about. And this is, in practice, what they do is reduce the dimensionality. But they do it in a way which I find totally unpalatable, which is they have experts say how to reduce the dimensionality. So you have a brain image, and they say, OK, well, let's. I know what this section is, so we'll just average together everything in the prefrontal cortex and so forth. So that is actually, in practice, what they do is just reduce the dimensionality. Though there's still a lot of these exploratory fishing studies where they look at individual voxels in this high dimensional space and they see these really high significance levels, and you'll still see plenty of stuff like that. But it's kind of a, it seems like kind of a disappointment to me that we have such all this data, but like it's causing more problems, more harm than good. So the question is whether we could really, do we really have to kind of throw away most of this high-dimensional data, or is there really some way that we might be able to learn with this very undersampled case, where n, the number of samples, is much less than the number of variables? So as you all know, and I think this lunch itself is even not free, you have to make some reasonable assumptions if you want to make this work. And ultimately, what makes your assumption reasonable is that it's going to work in some real data. The most, I think, powerful, or one of the most powerful and well-validated kind of simplicity priors that people use is sparsity. So for the types of problems we're going to talk about, which is kind of structure graphical learning problems, sparsity is really not enough to handle this degree of undersampling, because sample complexity grows slowly, but it does grow with dimensionality. So another class of methods, which I will be talking about, is latent factor models. So if the kind of degrees of freedom, oh yeah, sure. Yeah.
I mean, right, so they have 130,000 variables, which means they measured like 130,000 things.
Yeah, yeah.
But there's also the question, what do they want to get out of it, right? I mean, if they have 64 data points, do they just want to know, are they different? Do they want to, you know, fit the 160,000 variables?
Yeah.
What do they want to do with it?
Okay, cynically, they want to publish a lot of papers. So this is why, you know, like it's easy to say, oh, we found a significant effect and publish a paper. But in reality, I mean, no, that's not fair at all. In reality, there's a lot of things that they want to do that make the problem even worse in some ways. So one class of things is to study brain diseases. And sometimes you have rare brain diseases. And this makes the sampling problem even worse, right? Because you can't even get enough people that have this brain disease to get a lot of samples. So, sorry? Oh, no. Okay. So besides giving people brain diseases on purpose, in that case, they want to understand kind of the mechanisms behind these diseases. And then the other type of class of experiments, which are very popular, is that they put you in the scanner and they make you do a bunch of stuff. Like the example I'll talk about later is talking or making nonsense sounds. But it could be like moving your arm versus thinking about moving your arm. And they'd like to really see in this high dimensional space that they can detect sort of differences in how your brain works in that case. So with 130,000 variables, it's easy to find a voxel in your brain which like it looks super duper like a good predictor, but you know, it doesn't often really, it's not often very robust. Yeah. Yeah.
So from my understanding though is that a lot of these, especially brain mechanical systems, are relatively effective, which suggests that this problem is possible.
Yeah. Oh, and you know, I mean, some of these things, you know, like talking versus not talking, like, it's, you know, it's a huge difference in your brain states, so we can do that. But, like, I think ultimately they would like to do more fine-grained things, and that's going to require more statistical robustness someday. So at the moment, there's a lot of these kind of dramatic brain differences that are easy to detect. And it almost doesn't matter what you do. Dimensionality reduction, find some voxels, that's all going to work pretty well. Yeah. Yeah.
What's wrong with the out-of-sample prediction approaches that have been both popular and extensively used in the last couple of years?
What do you mean by out-of-sample? So you can certainly test your methods on some out-of-sample. Is that what you mean? Just see, you make a prediction and then you look at its performance on out-of-sample data.
Effectively
cross-validation. Yeah. And I think that's absolutely true. And there's also like not a lot of incentive. So it's very expensive to do the initial study. They try to use all the data they can. There's not as much incentive to do follow-up studies as well. So there's sort of a sociology of science component as well, that people aren't really incentivized to do these follow-ups that would tell you whether that result, first result, was garbage or not.
Well, that's not a fair answer, because you're simultaneously telling us that cross-validation is worthless, and then people aren't incentivized to do it.
No, that wasn't a statement that's worthless. I would say it's a different discussion. It is not a magic bullet.
Well, I'm not saying it's a magic bullet, but I'm looking to hear.
So,
why it's an invalid thing to do.
It's not an invalid thing to do. It's a great thing to do. You absolutely should do this. I'll talk about it at the end when I talk about the neuroscience results. That's how we're going to look at it. In fact, it's just, you know, you do a pilot study, and then you do sort of a follow-up study and see how well your results replicate. That's really just looking at the out-of-sample performance. So, you should definitely do it. Yeah, no doubt.
That's a sort of cross-study, cross-validation.
Okay, so... Right, which you can do, but like, man, 64 samples, what are we supposed to do? Go to 32 samples? Like, pretty soon, this is part of the problem, is that you have so few samples to start with, you're not rich enough to split up your data much more and still hope for your method to work. Like, you're always just on the borderline.
When you have 100,000 variables, let's say you compute the correlations and then you cross-validate them to see which ones are real, you will still be over cross-validating. Like with 100,000 samples, you still get false positives. 100,000 dimensions variables, you'll still have false positives.
I think so. I think that's what David is saying. And it if you have few enough samples, that's definitely a danger,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I agree with Chris. It's better than nothing.
Right. It's better than nothing. We should definitely do it. But
it's better than using all the data and claiming that things are correlated because you use all the data.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, to help these people out, what we really want to do is use this data more efficiently and have kind of more robust methods that really kind of utilize the high-dimensional data better. So that's really what I'm going to be talking about, is how we can do that. And kind of assumptions of low dimensionality help a little, but not really enough. So I'm going to talk about some other simplicity priors that we can kind of incorporate in our learning that seem to help in this super high-dimensional case. So that's the idea. And I'll start with a little bit of the theoretical part, where we see sort of a hint that if we make the right type of assumption about model structure, we might actually see a blessing of dimensionality. That is, our results might actually, even with a fixed number of samples, our results might get better if we increase the dimensionality. And then I'll talk about a method so that's just kind of a non-constructive theoretical arguments. And then we'll construct a method that seems to exhibit this kind of improvement with dimensionality. And then at the end, I'll talk about the brain stuff in more detail. But I probably will skip the stock stuff because you guys are very interactive, which I like. So, yeah. Oh, okay, good. Okay, so onto the equation part. So this is mostly to get to my notation, which is more like how the notation is in information theory, where capital X's would be like random variables, and they take, you know, values which are lowercase values like this. But whenever possible, we just minimize the notation and just write a probability distribution over some high-dimensional space like this, like P of X. We're going to talk about some like standard mutual information functionals, like mutual information. Mutual information between two random vectors, X and Z, can be written in a bunch of different ways. You could write it as a KL divergence between the joint distribution and the factorized distribution. You can write it as an expectation. So this is all just to get you used to my notation. If you haven't run across mutual information, just a measure of dependence in this case. Okay, so the other thing we need to fix is that we're going to talk a lot about graphical models. So we're going to look at graphical models that like this, where z's are going to be always going to be some hidden or latent factors in the graphical model, and the x's are always going to be some observed random variables. So you know, a graphical model like this has many different characterizations, which are equivalent. The most intuitive one, I think, is just that when you write a network like this, you're really saying that the joint probability distribution factorizes in some way, that, you know, variables only depend on their parents. Okay, so to make any theoretical statements, we're going to study like a really special and kind of narrow class of models. So the models we're going to study all have this form. We have some a fixed number of latent factors like this, and all of these variables that are observed have only a single parent in these latent factors. And we're even, to make the analysis simpler, we're going to say all the groups are kind of the same size. So that's some class of structures that we can study. And what we want to know is, like, how hard is it to recover a model of this form? And the way we're going to argue about that is to use these sort of information theoretic methods, which I know some of you are familiar with. So the way we turn this into sort of an information theory problem is as follows. So we say, OK, there's some discrete number of models. And I'll, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. OK, so when we talk about fMRI later, Xi is going to be like a single voxel, which can have some intensity level. And these Zs are going to be like, so there's, you know, we'll be finding kind of a cluster of voxels. And we'll say, you know, there's kind of a latent factor which explains the covariation of this group of voxels. Yeah. So that would mean that that there's really like a yeah that there's really a small number of latent factors which are like oh okay so first of all these assumptions are really for the theoretical analysis. It doesn't have to be the same number of x's actually later on. So for the theoretical results, that was derived in this case. But ultimately, the only thing that we're not even actually going to require that variables have only a single parent. There could be a little bit of overlap. What we're going to do is we're going to add kind of a regularizer to our latent factor models that says it prefers structure that has less overlap. Because you don't really expect to get like that would be like saying that your brain has like modules that are totally independent from each other. Yeah, yeah, totally. So that's a good point. And this kind of maybe confusing that this part is we're having a simpler setup for the theory, and then we'll try to make it a little more flexible as we go. Okay, so for this kind of simple setup, you can say, okay, I'm gonna turn it into a communication setting where I pick from these discrete models, and then I take this model, and now I'm gonna generate data according to that model, and I'm gonna generate n samples of data according to this graphical model. So at the end, what I get is a random matrix like this. So now the idea is I give you this random matrix, and then I see how well can you recover the original message that I intended to send, which was one of these indices. So that's how we make it into a communication problem. And once it's a communication problem, we can use all of the kind of standard things that we know about information theory. So in particular, we might want to ask a question like, what's the probability of an error in reconstructing theta given the random matrix that I just gave you? And that's easy. We can just use standard techniques like Fano's inequality to get a bound on that. So the way that that bound looks is like this. The probability of an error is lower bounded by something that involves the mutual information between theta, the original message, and x, the random matrix that I gave to you. So okay, so now we've turned this into a problem about estimating the mutual information between my message and your random matrix. And you can see that the amount of information that's here really depends on how many samples n that we've included. Yeah.
So each theta is a topology, or it also has all the, you know, the covariance matrix or whatever?
No, it's really, there's no topology or covariance. It really just is samples of these variables.
No, but I mean each,
yeah.
Each theta.
Oh, sorry. Yes, the theta is only the topology, and we're assuming that there's a fixed signal-to-noise ratio here, which I should have included.
Okay.
That there's, you know, each of these lines is some fixed signal-to-noise ratio. Yeah.
The actual model is Z1 is some number in each sample, and then we add independent Gaussian noise to each of its children, and they all have the same variance.
Exactly, yeah. Right, I should have just written that x equals square root signal noise ratio z parent plus Gaussian noise. Yeah.
So these are all real value variables?
Yeah, all real value. That's right.
And in particular, it's a mixture of Gaussians, right? Is it, that's what I understand, right? If z is like some point in R to the n, we're adding R1, we're adding Gaussian random noise, so this is a mixture of Gaussian model, and
So the z's are also Gaussian variables. So it's not a mixture. It's like if z were 0, 1, I'd say, yeah, it's a mixture of Gaussians. But it's really z is Gaussian. So xz is jointly Gaussian. And if you look at the marginal of just the x's, it's also just Gaussian, a high-dimensional Gaussian. Yeah.
Between samples, z's are resampled?
So between
samples.
Yeah, exactly. Z's are randomly sampled from a Gaussian distribution, an independent Gaussian. Yeah, that's right. No, we just make them fixed. So it's they're split up evenly in this scenario.
So the way he's going to give you capital M choices of topology, which might be all possible choices, might not.
It's a communication channel from theta to x, where z is actually being able to see x specifically.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. So we can use Fano's inequality. We just have to estimate this mutual information. Okay. So there's two things. So this log m is really just the number of models. So in this case, that's a really simple thing to estimate, and it's basically exponential in p. And we need to estimate this mutual information. So this is really the very challenging part of this problem. And you know, ultimately, we want to get statements about the number of samples, which is n, which is showing up inside this mutual information, which is very inconvenient. So what we use is a upper bound on mutual information from this paper, which allows us to upper bound it in terms of n times some other quantity, which I'm not showing. That helps us get n out. And once we have n out, we can rearrange everything to get a statement about how many samples we need to do this reconstruction of theta. So I'm going to skip kind of the algebra of it. But you end up getting a statement Let me go back to it. Yeah. Right, let's see. P variables.
Yes.
So that's the number of x's.
Yes,
so
that's
m factors.
And m is the number of factors.
Yeah, sorry. So the sort of dimensionality of the hidden space is very important.
Okay, so that's the number of factors, and n is the number of samples.
Yeah, right.
Is this inequality like for small n, or is it like a global n? Because it seems for it would asymptote eventually, right? It's an upper bound.
Yeah. Right, that's right. Yeah, so it's better for a small n, that's right. Yeah. Right, but and that's kind of what we care about is the when we have small samples. It's not going to be good in some limit, for sure. Okay, so when you rearrange it, it's actually not a very interesting form. So So the result is something like we can lower bound the number of samples that we need in terms of all these quantities. P, the number of variables, M, the number of latent factors, S is the signal-to-noise ratio, which I omitted, wasn't even on the slide. So instead of trying to understand this expression, I'm just going to plot an example of this so you can see what that result looks like. And I think it has kind of what was to me a kind of surprising structure. So what we have here is the lower bound on the number of samples we need as a function of the number of variables, P. So below this line, the theorem forbids us from doing perfect reconstruction of this of the structure, just the structure, not necessarily all the parameters that are part of the model. I mean that you got the exact theta, you got theta exactly right. Epsilon is a sort of a confidence parameter, so it could be that we want to get perfectly reconstruct theta, but we only need to do it 50% of the time or 90% of the time or something. Yeah, is that you get theta perfectly right with some probability. Yeah, so on this plot, there's some small epsilon, okay. Like with an error of like 5% or something. Okay. Or, sorry, yeah, that 5.
There's a threshold epsilon that you're not showing.
Yeah, so that's another parameter which can kind of make this taller or shorter, but doesn't have it doesn't really affect the shape at all. That's right. So this would say something like, you know, if we have a small number of variables and say 300 samples, the theorem prevents us from doing, you know, getting this perfect reconstruction with a certain confidence. But it looks like if we go to more variables, in principle, we might actually be able to do this reconstruction. So this is what I mean by a blessing of dimensionality, really, is that if you could show that you could do a good construction in this high dimensional regime, when you know it's forbidden in the low dimensional regime, then you can demonstrate that there is some sort of blessing of dimensionality for this problem.
Is the intuition behind this that you increase the number of variables that means your samples are running over these more variables, and so your communication channel, if you're not getting screwed by the number of thetas growing at the same rate, okay.
But this is if someone really tries to help you as much as possible and saying, well, I'll arrange the variables as best as I can.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like these samples, all the variables will be left, and here they will all be on the right.
Yeah, yeah. I think your intuitions are exactly right, which is that because we know this structure, like we kind of know that if we add more variables, I'm getting more noisy views of Z1. So more information is being transmitted. So maybe in some ways you could say that's not so surprising. We are getting more information. So the question is whether we can exploit that.
What's interesting is that it at least the bound on this side, and I actually chose another bound on the other side, that it beats the combinatorics of the set of possible structures.
Yeah. Right, right, right. Yeah, exactly. So, okay, so this is kind of a, okay, so I don't have a slide of upper bounds, which are pretty, so sort of like a spectral upper bound, which also shows kind of a decrease, but it's super loose. So what we're going to look at instead is some empirical results of like what happens in practice if we try to do this kind of structure reconstruction where we increase the number of variables. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. I am sure that this is kind of. I'm pretty sure this is a pretty loose lower bound. This is something I would really like to understand better. So, I would happily enlist any help on these fronts. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Do you know how this looks if instead of m being fixed, you have like p over m fixed or m over p fixed or everything? So, like we have 10
I'm not sure what the asymptotics would be like. Yeah. Yeah. So
somehow the reason this works is that if m is fixed, you only need to learn log m bits about each new variable, namely which group does it belong to.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Whereas each time you add a variable, you're also getting more information.
Yeah.
I would be worried that
yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if you already RK was 500 variables, right? It doesn't, and you add another variable to, even if it doesn't give any information, you can just drop it out. 500, where would you? It doesn't.
But the way he's defined the problem is we're not allowed to drop it out. We're supposed to assign it to a group.
Mm-hmm.
Well, also a related question, the number of variables per Z is held constant even if the number of variables grows?
Yeah. It has to divide the p variables into m groups. So that means each individual group is growing. Yeah, and that's right. So every group is growing, so you get more chances to recover that z. Yeah. So in some ways, right, the bound is probably not tight, but in some ways it seems kind of intuitive if we could just like take advantage of this fact. So I'm going to flip to the kind of empirical look at this to see that, like, hey, maybe we can actually take advantage of this.
Just take a decimation of the set of all possible thetas. Just randomly, before you do your experiments, there's the dimension.
Sorry, it just started flickering a little bit. Okay. Sorry, so what's your question while we... Yeah.
Offline, so
yeah.
Where I see the data,
yeah.
Decimate the set of all possible thetas to a much smaller set. Now, and assuming that that's got some coverage.
Yeah.
Now you would expect that your actual statistics would be even better.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that log m term?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you just do something like that, you have much greater confidence.
Yeah, I'll think about that. It makes sense that this might help though. But let me keep going and maybe talk about that later.
That's a proposal to recover the model approximately.
Yeah. Which would be nice actually, because the results, these empirical results are for approximate recovery, and this is like a really annoying mismatch. That this bound I just showed you is for perfect recovery, but now all the methods we're gonna show for structure recovery are only approximately recovering it. They're getting 99% of the links right. So this would be really what we need to do to draw a tighter connection. Yeah, I think that's the right thing to do actually. So just to give you what these empirical results look like. So again, we're looking at how well we can recover structure as we increase the number of variables. But we said that this model structure is very simple. It's really just clustering all the variables with respect to their latent factors. And that means we can compare against a lot of regular methods that just do clustering. So just to see how this looks, for this type of model, we try to do clustering, and we measure the quality in terms of normalized mutual information, which goes between 0 and 1. So perfect performance would be if we got a 1. That's really what the theorems were about, whether we could do this in the high-dimensional case. So these methods, I won't talk about most of them, but there's factor analysis and ICA, PCA, spectral. This is latent tree modeling, which I'll talk about especially. There's nothing, this doesn't look very good. This is sort of what we normally expect when we increase the dimensionality, that there's really no benefit from doing that. So the method I'm going to talk about tries to exploit this kind of structure that things shouldn't overlap too much, and we get results more like this. So it does see a benefit as the dimensionality goes up, and it's sort of approaching this perfect performance, but I don't think we'll actually quite get there, which is why we probably really need to do something like you were suggesting. So this is mainly to keep your interest in the second part of the talk, where we talk about how are we going to accomplish this? How are we going to try to exploit this dimensionality as we go up? So I wanted to say something about latent tree modeling, because I think it's especially interesting here. So this purple line is latent tree modeling, and in the low dimensional case, it actually really outperforms everything. So there's a really nice set of theory built up about latent tree models, but they're all based on that the first thing that you do is you get your data and you estimate the pairwise covariances between variables, and then you use that to determine the structure before you actually try to infer the latent factors. So they have sort of a consistency results that this will work, but only if the number of samples grows with the dimension. So that's why in the low dimensional case, we see it does really well. But in the high dimensional case, these sort of, you don't have enough samples to estimate these pairwise covariances. So anyway, this seems interesting to me because I think it's a kind of a limitation of what you can do with looking at pairwise covariance as the dimensionality grows. Okay, so this is, so we're going to talk about how we can try to exploit this non-overlapping structure, and then talk about just the application to brains, since there's a lot of interest in that. Though, how late do you guys normally go with this? I might have to cut some of the method part. Okay, no, no, it's okay. So anyway, we'll get to that. So I first want to say what I'm not going to try and do. So I think a normal way to approach this problem would be to just say, you know, let's look at all the possible structures and see which one maximizes the log likelihood of the data. And that would definitely work, I'm guessing, or I'm pretty sure it would work. But it would be too expensive because there's combinatorially many of these structures that we'd have to sort through. So we don't want to do that. And like I just said, we don't really want to find the structure first by looking at these pairwise covariances. That's how the latent tree modeling worked, and that seemed to fail in high dimensions. Okay, so what are we going to do instead? So to introduce kind of the main idea for how we're going to do more of like a global optimization instead of looking at local structure, I'm going to introduce one more bit of notation, which is about conditional independence. So this quantity I'm going to define TCX, or the total correlation in X conditioned on Z, is really the KL divergence between the joint distribution of X conditioned on Z and the factorized distribution. So this is kind of a useful quantity to look at because if this quantity were zero, then that means that P of X given Z perfectly factorizes. In other words, the X's are conditionally independent conditioned on the Z's. So we just want to measure TCX given Z so that if we were to minimize this measure, we would get conditional independence. So that's why we're introducing this. Okay, so all right, so we have that. So what we're going to do is proceed in sort of the opposite of generative modeling perspective. So the generative modeling perspective is that you imagine a latent factor model where the Z's generate the X's. We're going to start in the opposite direction. We're going to say that we have some X's, and we're going to learn some functions, P of Z given X. And the reason we do that is it's easy to sample data that way. Like if we have this model, we have some X's, we can generate some Z's. It's easy. In this case, if we have our X's, it's actually hard to infer the posterior on Z. So that's why we're going to start the way with this model on the top, the one that's easy to sample from. Now, ultimately, so this helps us make a joint distribution of X and Z, but we really would like this model to be close to a generative model if possible. And the way we can do that is to note that if we have a generative model, I guess it's really equivalent to some conditional independence statements. So that's another way to characterize our Bayesian networks. And this just says the Z's are independent, or TCZ is zero, and the X's are independent conditioned on the Z, so TCX conditioned on Z is zero. So we have a model that's not a generative model, but we'd like it to be close to one. All we have to do is minimize this information theoretic functional. And if we were to find a global minimum where both of these are zero, it would be equivalent to saying that there is a generative model of this form, that the X's and Z's do factorize in the correct way. So that's the kind of dual approach to generative modeling that we're gonna take on. At this point, we haven't introduced any structure for the Z's and X's. And if you look at the mathematics behind this, it ends up looking just like variational inference, actually. Which maybe doesn't surprise some of you. So we wanted to include some structure. And the structure we wanted to include was that we wanted to encourage that models like this would be encouraged, I guess. So to do that, we want to specify this class of models in terms of some conditional independence statements. So these models still obey the same two first requirements, that the Z's are independent and the X's are independent conditioned on Z. And they satisfy one additional conditional independence constraint, or set of constraints, which is that the Z's are independent conditioned on Xi. So this is kind of a regularizer that we're going to impose to encourage the latent factor models we learn to have structure that looks like this.
Overlap. The second line is the TC of all of the X's conditioned on all of the Z's.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So you can imagine the scenario where X1 has two parents, both Z1 and Z2. Now, if we condition on X1, the Z's are no longer independent, because by conditioning on it, the Z's have a common effect. And from a deseparation point of view, conditioning actually breaks the deseparation. So if there's any X that has two parents, this messes up the separation of the Z's, which are unconditionally independent to begin with. I should have an example with just two Z's up there. That would actually make it really easy. Yeah, that's right. Or at least quantify the sense in which this model includes X's with multiple parents. Because we'd like to keep the sort of amount of overlap as small as possible.
Okay, now again, thinking in terms of brain.
Yeah, yeah.
Why would I necessarily expect that one particular voxel can't be lit up for more than one particular whatever is supposed to represent?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think you'd kind of hope that. So you might think that they're like little modules that of voxels that all light up together. And if you know about that module, you basically know as much as you about this individual voxel, but it's still we ultimately need to test that whether that's reasonable.
Kind of like localized function assumption, you know, that each thing tends to correspond, each location of the brain tends to correspond to a particular function, right?
Yeah, that's right. I'm actually even more. I mean, what worries me more is actually the independence of the Z's to begin with. The latent factors themselves are not independent at all, and that's something I'd like to get rid of even more than this overlap thing.
I'm just thinking like X is like in the prefrontal cortex where the whole point of it is supposed to be that's involved in everything.
Exactly right. So,
you would think that it's got all the Z's in it.
Yeah. Yeah. Or that there's some like higher level Z which actually correlates all these Z's. Yeah.
Right. The two X together, if you allow the Z's to not be independent, then you could have the X's be independent or depend on only one Z and you just pipe it through the Z. And if in the other way. So it's only when they act together that's a big assumption. If you take each assumption on its own, it's not an assumption.
Right. Okay, so anyway, let me go to the brain stuff, because that's so ultimately we're just doing the same optimization. We're trying to make it close to a generative model. We're going to add a regularizer that says that we would like to have this overlap property, non-overlap property, as much as possible.
And the point is that you can write down this optimization without, this is not moving around in this combinatorial space of possible partitions.
Exactly. Right, it's an unconstrained optimization, and that's nice. And for this unconstrained optimization, we can find a nice quasi-Newton scheme that's linear in the number of variables. So we can do this pretty fast, actually, which is nice. This is sort of the important part about the method, and I'm not going to talk about any more details besides that. I think it does have tons of local optima. And the other thing which is in the paper and not here is that what we find is that if you have a lot of very strong dependence in the data, it seems to induce a lot of strong local optima. So what we actually do is kind of an annealing scheme where we add noise on purpose, which kind of reduces the range of the objective and leads to kind of a smoother surface, and then we slowly reduce the noise. And this had this basically wouldn't work without doing that. And the reason is that it immediately, with strong correlations, it would immediately get into a local optimum. So I wouldn't say I understand it, but it's definitely a big component. Yeah.
I was just curious on that point. Like, I noticed in this formula here, you don't have weighting factors between the different components. And I was wondering if a similar thing, if you had a really strong, say, TCX given Z is zero, factor that might have
Sorry, I guess I didn't.
Which of these equalities do you care about the most?
Okay, and so there's more details in here. One is that we have to weight these the same because there's a simplification where some annoying terms drop out. The second is that the way we add this also has sort of a constrained form where, like, if we add it in a certain way, the whole thing is very tractable, and if we add it in a different way, it doesn't work at all. So it's a good question. It would be nice if you could control all those things separately. Because, you know, like, if we want to, maybe we have a problem where we think there's actually more overlap. It would be nice if we could relatively relax that constraint, and there's really not a way to do it in this special scheme. That's right. Yeah. Sorry, no worries.
Would just be the average of the x's that it because of the way you define the independent Gaussian noise. So I'm a little confused as to when we do the minimum over the probability distribution of z sub j given x.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like, are you minimizing that over a certain family of probability distributions? Are they linear ones?
Sorry, it's linear. I should write this as zj is, you know, wx plus
so
Gaussian noise. But those Gaussian noises can have different variances. Yes. Sorry. Yeah. I gotta change that. So the general idea could maybe work for different ZJs given X's, but this particular implementation is for linear latents.
And then you can interpret the large coefficients that you get there as giving you roughly the partition.
Exactly. Yeah. Right.
If you like first just run regular EM or something like that, and then start the optimization from there, do you still have to do these tricks where you inject noise?
So just to remind you, this is the, you know, I was trying to sell this method. It's like, hey, we can do this. This is that cluster structure recovery. And really, the FA is a regular latent factor analysis, which uses an EM procedure. And it really doesn't work to find this structure.
But just to set the initial weights that you then
took. And I haven't experimented with setting the initial weights, because it already converges pretty fast regardless. So, yeah. There it goes again, inopportunely. So I'm going to skip the stock market results, because we've talked about a lot of things, and everyone's keen about brains. It works really well for kind of modeling covariances of stocks. And there's a lot of interesting methods, like Bayesian methods, Bayesian shrinkage methods for covariance estimation that it beats out, and Glasso, and a bunch of other famous things. So I'll skip that one. Want me to try it again? I really wanted to. So you know, there's this whole, probably not, because there's like too much other stuff I have to learn. But you know, like, covariance estimation is classically used to, if you want to minimize the variance of your portfolio, you need to know how much things are correlated. So in principle, if you have a better way of estimating the correlations, should be able to get a better idea of the risk. But I don't know. There's a lot of work involved, and I have like a real job as well. So anyway, it's like fallback plan is definitely make money on the stock market. Right. So we do well in this problem where we're doing negative log likelihood. And the factors also seem to be like things that are really interpretable, like very specific sectors, and a diverse kind of variety of different sectors come out. So anyway, but I wanted to focus on the neuroscience stuff. So, you know, I made this argument about poor reproducibility of results in neuroscience. And so, you know, it's also the most undersampled of the data sets. So I was curious to see whether we could actually get any advantage in this regime. So the data set, just to remind you, so we have these 130,000 variables. Those are the voxels in this fMRI imaging. And for this data set, we have 64 samples per subject. And the people who are in the scanner will have 32 scans in condition one and 32 scans in condition two. And condition one is that they're talking, and condition two, they're making nonsense syllables like e-e-e-e. Okay, so that's the data. So the first thing that we're going to look at is, what if we just ran some different methods on this very undersampled data to see, like, what do the latent factors look like in terms of the structure that they learn? So here are some brain pictures, which are pretty. These are PCA and ICA. And the structure looks pretty much like nonsense. Two other methods that we can talk about are factor analysis. So this is a latent, another latent factor analysis method, which actually looks pretty good. And this is the method I've been talking about, which also looks pretty good. So these are really like which voxels are clustered together. But it's pretty hard to read these because there's a hundred, like, you know, 100 or 200 different groups, and they all have different, slightly different shades. So all you can really tell from these things is that this learned a very non-smooth structure, and these methods learned somewhat smoother structure.
And none of these methods are given any information about the position of the voxel.
Right, they don't know that these voxels are next to each other or not. They're trying to learn this just based on the... Yeah, though it's hard to tell because the clusters, colors look different. It might look different even though they're kind of similar. So one thing we could do is just say, like, well, we know something about what the right clusters of the brain are, or experts have ideas about what the right clusters are. So just to like give kind of a small sanity check, we could say, how well do these recover structure we know about? So so we're doing this in this very undersampled regime with 64 samples from a single person. And we want to see how well they can recover a cluster. So we use one of the famous atlases. I don't know. There's a handful of different brain atlases people use with different numbers of clusters. And I think this is one reason to, well, a more data-driven approach seems like it could be nice, right? So, but anyway, just to see whether any of the known structure pops out from these methods, we do a little bit better at recovering some of the known structure, but I wouldn't read too much into it because experts themselves disagree about what the right number of clusters and what the right clusters are. So instead, I wanted to talk about this idea of, you know, can we really help with improving the reproducibility of results by finding doing this type of regularized latent factor analysis. So we're going to do an out-of-sample kind of study where, well, depending on how you define. So we're going to take this data and we're going to mix it up, and we're going to take the first 300 samples to be sort of the training data, or the exploratory study, if you want to think of it that way. And then we're going to try to validate those results on a much larger test set, which we'll call the replication study. So if we find a large effect size, where effect size is going to be how well can we predict whether that person was talking or making nonsense syllables. So we're going to do unsupervised dimensionality reduction. And then we're going to see if by doing this in different ways, we get more reliable supervised results on telling like which latent factors are predictive of the task.
So you would use the Z's rather than the X's?
Yeah, that's right. So and we'll compare with using the Z's, or with using the raw X's, and using Z's that are coming from the experts. So does that make sense? Okay. So this Cohen's D is a measure of effect size that they sometimes use. Right, it's just like how big is the difference between the treated and the control populations. So for a single voxel, Cohen's D would be like, you know, the activation of this voxel is, you know, a standard deviation bigger than when people are talking than when they're not talking. So they'd say Cohen's D, the effect size for this voxel is 1. And we're going to check that for different learned latent factors as well, learned in this unsupervised way. Yeah. So what can happen here? So let me give a landscape of this chart. So this D1 is going to be the effect size on the original data for different features, where it's either the raw data or latent factors or whatever. And what we're gonna find is that so we put in some significance lines here where we say, based on some criteria, that if the effect size is small, it's not significant. If it's above this, it's some significant effect. But anything in this quadrant is sort of insignificant, and it won't be significant in the first study, and in the second study, it's also not significant. So we don't care about that stuff. This is sort of the range that we have a problem with, which is that a lot of the studies are going to find significant effects, but when we look at the bigger replication, they're not going to hold up. Up here is another problematic area where we missed an effect in our original study but actually they seem like they were more, they were significant in a follow-up study. And this is where we really want to be, is out here, where we found a big effect in the original study and it replicated in the follow-up. Okay, so one more little feature here is that this is sort of the region where it looks like you got like a super duper big effect, like an effect size of one, but actually it only really just barely passed significance in the follow-up study. So sorry to give you the whole landscape. This is how I think of it anyway. Oh, wow. And you'll never know what happens here.
That slide is begging for a different background.
Different, a tropical background. Yeah, if I could find one with the right topography. Oh, sorry, oh shoot, okay. Right. Okay, where's my arrow? So I can get rid of this. Wow. It's quite sensitive. Okay, now I can get rid of this guy, maybe. If I can. Oh, did you see it? Oh, there it is. There it is. Okay. Okay. So this is all 130,000 voxels. We look at every voxel and we see if it's a significant predictor of whether you're talking or.
I'm sorry. This is all synthetic data.
This is real data. This is
real data where you subsample to 300.
No. So this is. There's 130,000 points, one for every voxel in the brain. For every voxel, we look whether it has a significant, whether it has a strong effect size for predicting speech.
This is the raw data. Anyway.
The raw data. And I mean, there really are, sorry? No, it's the number of, right, variables in the brain, the number of voxels in the brain. So we could try to use every voxel to do this prediction and say, oh, voxel one, you know, has a very strong effect size for predicting.
Wait, so
oh, so yeah, n 300 is the number of fMRI slices. In this case, we used images, multiple images from multiple people. Yeah, sorry, because I was talking about a single individual before. This we had to mix a few people to get enough samples to even do the follow-up study, so we could do this. That's right. And so what you see is that, you know, this is like your normal concern about family-wise error rate. If you have super duper many hypotheses, you're going to find many that have strong effect sizes that don't replicate. But even with individual voxels, it seems like you get some that replicate, though almost always they're sort of exaggerated, and the replicated effect size is a bit smaller. Probably. Yeah. So, okay, so we know that there's this problem with too many hypotheses. So we're going to do dimensionality reduction. And we have a whole bunch of ways of doing that. And we want to see how things look on this landscape when we do dimensionality reduction. So an easy thing to do would be PCA, where we're always going to reduce to this 212 components with the idea that there's 212 brain regions according to this atlas. So the components you get are kind of underwhelming, which is why people probably don't do this very often. So we don't get any effects that replicate from doing dimensionality reduction with PCA. If we do the same thing with ICA, it's a similar story. We don't get a significant effect that then replicates. Factor analysis gets one hit up here, where it gets something that's very significant, but then it's just barely significant in the follow-up study. Yeah, they all have 212 factors. That's right. Because what we want to compare with is the experts, because the experts have their own way of reducing the dimensionality. We really want to see how they're doing. Yeah, sure.
Just one comment on the
experts. Yeah, yeah.
The techniques you're using are anatomically based.
Yes.
Atlases, and there's no guarantee whatsoever that function needs to map onto anatomy in any one-to-one bit of a misnomer to say that the experts are trying to do the same kind of functional prediction that this study is trying to do.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah. No, sorry, it's the anatomical regions. That's all I mean. And you're right, that's maybe misleading to say. Ideally, we would use different atlases and maybe find one. Maybe there are ones that are more geared towards functional regions. And
The problem is, in principle, and it looks like from the way the data are going, this is going to be borne out, that the anatomy predicts a lot less of the functional results than some people would have thought going in.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right. And that's exactly right. So these purple points are the anatomical regions. And indeed, we see that generally these anatomical regions aren't much better predictors, though it does get maybe one or two significant replications up here. So not too bad. And then finally, we want to compare our new method for finding latent factors that are relatively not too overlapping in the brain. Sorry? Yeah, I know. All right. So OK, but it's not very good because it's just a single point. It looks kind of dumb. So we get these two points up here, which have very strong replication, and the kind of replicated effect size looks pretty big, or is sort of in line with what the effect size was on the training data. Yeah, that's right.
So if you then looked for linear combinations and so on,
you
could do any number of additional.
Maybe. But then we'd have even more dangers of overfitting.
Exactly.
So that's a good point.
You'd be running onto these shoals of additional hypotheses.
Yeah.
But there can't be more than one because isn't one or two good enough? I mean,
I think so. Ultimately, one of the things that neuroscientists would be interested in is show me a region which has some functional significance and is very predictive of speech. That could be a big win by itself. So it's 212 factors and 130,000 voxels. So that means we're getting these sort of many thousands of voxel sized regions in the brain. Right.
So that's an interesting question. Are they spatially?
Right.
That's not.
No, so that previous plot was really, this isn't like, this was sort of to convince you that they're at least somewhat spatially contiguous, but we don't have like a measure of like exactly how contiguous they are. So.
But that's different variance you're parsing there, right?
This was with even fewer samples, but with more samples, it looks even more smooth, I guess, spatially.
I know from working with MRI data that neighboring voxels are incredibly correlated, most of the correlation.
Yeah.
Some for natural causes and some because every little movement of the head
right.
correlates stuff.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If it were that simple, then the PCA would also produce smooth regions.
Yeah. Right, because it's so undersampled. Okay. So let me, we're getting to the end of our thing. I just have a slide or two to wrap up. I would never trust a point like this anyway. So what I did was kind of replicate this experiment many times by breaking up the data set in different ways to see whether it was just like we just got lucky this one time that we got a latent factor that was good. So the way to look at this is, good thing I wrote it here because I forgot how that is. Effect size and replication study of the effect that, right, so we look for the largest effect in the original study, and we see what its effect size is in the replicated study. And when we do this over many different ways of constructing the study, we still get a pretty robust effect that we find larger effect sizes. So, we learn a new model every time. I don't know. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So even though the best effect is a good predictor, if it's a different region every time, you're not very happy with it. Yeah. So you're right. It'd be nice to know.
First 50 voxels, that's the Z that you should look at. So it gives you the wrong answer every time.
Hmm.
Right, I think that's David's point. Right, is if it's giving you different answers every time, then who knows? If they're all giving you the same answers every time, then that's great. And then some are better than others.
You're saying there are stupid ways to give you the same answer every time.
Right.
But
yeah.
The algorithm is is permutation symmetry.
Yeah.
I mean, if you know.
Yeah.
That means an obvious thing to do, though, to see
yeah.
if you are getting the same models for all these folds.
Yeah. So we haven't really, this is pretty preliminary, and that's really the next step is to work with our collaborators to say, like, okay, are we seeing anything interesting functionally?
Right.
Just see that they overlap. And I haven't, that's, you're right, that's an obvious thing which I haven't tried, just to make sure that all of these good solutions have high overlap.
Same solution.
Yeah, totally.
Right.
Yeah.
And see how often do you get something equivalent.
Mm-hmm.
So you do a permutation so that there is no real signal.
Oh yeah. Right.
And then you see how often do I get a point that's up there in the
Right. Yeah, that would be nice. Yeah, that makes sense too. So we could see that like there's no way that you would get this kind of large replicated signals by chance just by using a method that somehow is good at finding things that are maybe stable, not necessarily things that are very good predictors.
Just one other historical perspective on the dimensionality problem. This is only relatively recent, i.e. mid-90s to 2000, because of the invention of functional MRI. Before that, the problem was exactly the opposite. You could only measure simultaneously a dead few, like tens, and people were, their holy grail was to get as many of these simultaneous measurements as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not what fMRI gives you, but it gives you as many dimensions as you could possibly want and more.
Right.
And so the field kind of turned on its head as a result of that. But still, you can only record from a few hundred neurons simultaneously.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The key is simultaneously. You can't do covariances unless you've got simultaneous measurements. So, and the 200 that you can get or the 1,000 that you can get is still in a relatively spatially contiguous region. So you can't ask whole brain questions like you're asking.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, gene expression is another thing we've looked at a lot. That's good. Yeah.
64 samples from gene expression.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. That's really it. So I view reality as kind of a high-dimensional vector, and we only get a few samples of it. So it's depending on how you slice up your life, the number of samples is not enough. Thanks. So, we really want to use those as efficiently as possible, and it seems like as humans walking around, we're pretty good about this stuff. We're not, like, so overwhelmed by the number of neurons coming into our system that, like, we can't learn anything. We learn a lot of stuff really easily. I think there's a lot of low-hanging fruit with simple assumptions like this that make it easy to sort of, find modules in the high-dimensional data. So this is still more simplistic than I'd like it to be. There's some of the things we talked about, like maybe we should have more overlaps in latent factors or in the observed things. And we want to see if we can do that while still preserving this kind of blessing of dimensionality. The other thing is that these bounds are all not very tight. this, I think, is a really interesting thing to figure out. When exactly do we get blessings of dimensionality? Under what assumptions? And that would be awesome to know. And of course, you know, seeing that these are useful in real data is the most important thing. If this type of assumption gave us junk on all the real data sets we looked at, then it wouldn't be worth investigating. But I think it's been kind of promising on a few different domains that we've looked at so far. So yeah, thanks everybody. Thank you.